And it's a real, real pleasure for me to talk to all of you. And because this keeps me also motivating. Yes, I think about you and about the topic for the whole week, and that is good. Yes, so I'm thankful to all of you. Yes, and then we start for the day. As usual, I would be doing very simple stuff, and we would make a small recap of a few things, and then we proceed. Basically, we want to talk about the. We want to obtain the solutions of the equations, field equation of motion, following from the Polyakov action, and we found that it's much easier to understand the whole thing in terms of the light front coordinates, right? And so we express our theory in light front coordinates. We understand it piece by piece. What is the measure? What is the new metric? And what is the new equation of motion? And then we can proceed to solve this. And the meaning becomes a little more clear in the light front coordinates. Why? Because in the light front coordinates, we combine our usual tau and sigma worksheet instant form coordinates, tau and sigma, as tau plus sigma and tau minus sigma. And we call it the light front time, sigma plus, which is tau plus sigma, and sigma minus is tau minus sigma, which is the usual longitudinal spatial coordinate. Then the advantage of this is that we are eventually solving a wave equation, right? And wave equation we know from ordinary mechanics that you can write down the solution of a one-dimensional wave equation in terms of a superposition of two solutions, one going to the left and one going to the right. And the same thing happens with the relativistic strings. So in the ordinary mechanics, they were non-relativistic strings, but one could write down the solution as a superposition of the two waves, one traveling to the left, one traveling to the right. So the same thing holds true also for the relativistic string. So our solution x of mu, which is our string coordinates on the one hand, and which is a two-dimensional field on the bird sheet. So for the bird sheet, it's a scalar field, right? Mm-hmm. So we want to solve the field equation for x mu, and this is a wave equation. And we want to express x mu as a sum of two solutions. One is the left moving wave and one is the right moving wave. So one is purely a function of sigma plus and one is purely a function of sigma minus. This is the main idea. Okay. So, and if you look from the point of view of the tau and sigma coordinates, then this x mu, we call it a function of sigma plus, and put a subscript L, so left moving and right moving. This from the point of view of the tau and sigma coordinates, they look like left moving and right moving waves. Okay, one depends purely on tau minus sigma, one depends purely on tau plus sigma. Okay, that's the idea. And then what next we would like to do, so we would also recap some basics, not immediately, but as the time comes, some essentials of simple quantum mechanics in brief, in short, and then field theory. So we would just take the example of a real scalar field theory and a complex scalar field theory. And why we need help of these examples? Because what we want to do eventually, we want to consider these solutions of our field equation x mu as a sum of two components or two objects which are left moving and right moving waves. And these are, at the moment, they are classical fields. But we would like to move on to the corresponding quantum mechanical theory, to the corresponding quantum theory. And how do we do it? Just the situation is just parallel and analogous to quantum mechanics. Like I have a one-dimensional harmonic oscillator. I have one coordinate x and one momentum p, or p of subscript x. So momentum p, which is conjugate to x. For one-dimensional harmonic oscillator with just one x and one p, then I can expand my x as a linear sum of annihilation and creation operators. And of course, at that moment, I would promote my x to the corresponding quantum mechanical operator, because the left-hand side and right-hand side of an equation, they have to be operators on both the sides. So my x is an operator expressed as a linear sum of annihilation and creation operators. And I can derive my p from the Lagrangian. This p also could be expressed as a linear sum of the annihilation and creation operators. And we call it, you can call it Fock space decomposition. It's a more general term after Herr Fock, F-O-C-K Fock. And here, the number density operator or number operator n, which is a product of a dagger times a, creation operator sitting to the left and annihilation operator sitting to the right. So one can express the theory in terms of the number operator, and this number operator in Fock space is diagonal. So the Hamiltonian would automatically be simultaneously diagonalized in this representation. That is the advantage. And supposing I have a double oscillator. So I have x1, p1 and x2, p2. I have two coordinates, x1, x2 and two momenta, p1, p2. Then I would need to do the same thing again. What I would do, I would express my x1 as a linear combination of a1 and a1 dagger and x2 as a linear combination of a2 and a2 dagger with suitable coefficients, okay, with appropriate coefficients. So here I would have two sets of annihilation and creation operators. This gradually brings us close to our string theory. Okay. Here you see I have my x mu, which is a sum of the left moving and right moving waves. I can make an analogous Fourier mode expansion of these fields, left moving and right moving fields or waves. Then I would need some to introduce annihilation and creation operators. And if I have two, so left moving and right moving, they are completely independent modes. And therefore, I would need two sets of annihilation and creation operators. Okay. Now, I just talk a little bit about field theory. If I have a real scalar field theory involving only one scalar field, phi. Okay. So, Lagrangian is 1 half d mu phi minus 1 half m square phi square. Now, I can expand this phi, again the focus space decomposition of phi, and I introduce one annihilation and one creation operator in the simplest consideration of the plane wave expansion. Even one could consider cylindrical waves or spherical waves, but plane waves does our purpose to understand the basics of the theory. So, and then I describe the theory, everything in terms of this set of annihilation and creation operators A and A dagger. And my number density operator is also 1, N, which is a function of A dagger times A. But supposing I have a complex scalar field theory. So my Lagrangian is d mu phi star d mu phi. Now I have, of course, the mass term phi star phi times m square. Now my fields phi and phi star are two independent fields. So I need to make the focus space decomposition by introducing two sets of annihilation and creation operators. Okay, and I could equivalently express my phi and phi star in terms of two real scalar fields, phi 1 and phi 2, and I could define phi equal to phi 1 plus I phi 2, whole thing divided by square root of 2, and square root of 2 is just for convenience. Okay, and then phi star becomes phi 1 minus I phi 2. I will write down also all these equations, but I am giving you a flow chart.